Another example of an undecidable decision problem is a question of whether a Diophantine equation has a solution or not. A Diophantine equation is a polynomial equation in multiple variables, but the variables can only take positive integer values. For example, we could ask whether there are positive integer values for x1, x2, x3, x4, and x5 such that the equation 3 times x1 times x2 squared times x3 plus 5 times x2 times x4 times x5 is equal to 8 is satisfied. If you stare at this equation for some time, you will see that there is a solution for this equation. If we set all the variables to 1, for example, then this equation is satisfied. We have 3 times 1 times 1 squared times 1, so that's just 3, and then we have plus 5 times 1 times 1 times 1, that is just 5, so 3 plus 5 is 8. How about this example? x1 cubed plus x2 cubed minus x3 cubed equals 0. Can this be satisfied by positive integers x1, x2, and x3? This is much harder to see. It turns out that this cannot be satisfied. So there is no solution in positive integers for this equation. But this is not obvious. It is, however, a consequence of Fermat's last theorem. If you don't remember Fermat's last theorem, this is the theorem. It states that the equation x to the power of n plus y to the power of n equals z to the power of n has no solution in positive integers for any integer n at least 3. So x1 cubed plus x2 cubed minus x3 cubed equals 0 is a special case of this theorem where n equals 3. So these are two examples of Diophantine equations, and in both examples we were able to determine whether they have a solution or not. In the first case this was simple. In the second case we actually needed a quite advanced theorem to see this. So you can see that this is not a trivial problem, and in fact this problem is undecidable, so there is no Turing machine that decides automatically whether a given Diophantine equation has a solution or not. But let us talk about Fermat's last theorem some more. Fermat's last theorem was an elusive conjecture for about 350 years. Before it was eventually proven in 1994. So for 350 years it was not known whether this conjecture is true or not, so whether there exists some equation of the form x to the power of n plus y to the power of n equals z to the power of n that has a positive integer solution for some n at least equal to 3. Now, of course, this was a very famous conjecture, so people were trying to resolve it one way or another, so they were either trying to prove the conjecture or to disprove the conjecture. To disprove the conjecture, all you would have to do is to find positive integers x, y, z, and n such that they satisfy this equation and such that n is at least 3. So, at first, people would just try a few different numbers and see if they work, and whether they give a counterexample to Fermat's last theorem. But then, computers were invented. So, why would you do this by hand? You could just ask a computer to generate numbers for x, y, z, and n, and try them, and then tell you once they found a solution. So, here would be a simple computer program that we could write to try all possible values for x, y, z, and n in the search of a counterexample to Fermat's last theorem. Our program uses a variable called t, And we will initialize t equal to 3, but you could initialize it with a larger value as well. And then we have a big loop. And inside the loop, we try all possible values for x, y, z, and n between their possible starting values. So for x, y, z, it would be 1, and for n, it would be 3, up to t. And then we test whether they satisfy this equation. So we would have a loop going through all values of n. So from n equals 3 to t. And then inside of that, we have a loop trying all the values for x equals 1 to t. And then a loop inside that for y equals 1 to t. And then for z equals 1 to t. And then we just test whether those values satisfy the equation. So we test whether x to the power n plus y to the power n equals z to the power n. And if this is the case, then clearly we found a counterexample. So we return yes, or we return 1. And if not, then we haven't found a counterexample. So Fermat's last theorem is true for all the numbers up to t. But maybe t was just not large enough. So we now increase t by 1 and then go through the loop again. And we keep doing this. Clearly, if there is a counterexample to Fermat's last theorem, this program will eventually find it and return 1. If there's no counterexample to Fermat's last theorem, well, then this program will never terminate. It will just get stuck in this loop and keep increasing t larger and larger, but never actually terminate. So this is quite interesting, right? So if Fermat's last theorem is false and there's a counterexample, then this program will halt and find this counterexample. But if Fermat's last theorem is true, and there is no counterexample, then this program will not halt. Assume for a minute that we could decide the halting problem. Then we could also decide whether Fermat's last theorem has a counterexample or not. So maybe we wouldn't have had to wait 350 years for somebody to prove the theorem. We could have just used a computer, and the computer could have told us, yes, there is a counterexample, or no, there is no counterexample for this statement. Of course, it's possible that your Turing machine that decides the halting problem would have run for more than 350 years to determine whether this program halts or not. But that's besides the point. The point is that we wouldn't have had to do any extra work. We could have just fed this problem into a computer, and the computer would have done its thing and then give us the correct answer and automatically detect whether there's a counterexample or not. Indeed, this works not just for Fermat's last theorem. Something like this works for any mathematical conjecture. Suppose we have some type of formal language in which we can write down conjectures and also mathematical proofs. And we can do so in such a way that a computer program can automatically verify the given proof step by step and check that it's really a proof, a valid proof for the conjecture. So it would check that every step of the proof somehow follows logically from the previous steps and the axioms, and that in the end, the statement you get is equal to the conjecture. This is not hypothetical. Such systems do indeed exist. If we have something like this, then what we could try to do to see if a conjecture has a proof or not, we could just try every potential proof, and proofs are just bit strings, and check whether this potential proof, this bit string, is indeed a correct proof for the conjecture. So basically, we just write down some sequence of random symbols and see if that happens to be a proof for the conjecture we are dealing with. And if it's not a proof, then we could try some other random sequence of symbols. And rather than using like arbitrary random sequences of symbols, we would just systematically try every possible bit string. We would enumerate all the bit strings and for each one check whether it's a correct proof for our conjecture. So you could write a program that looks roughly like this. I mean, this is just pseudocode, but you get the idea. We have a big loop, and in this loop, we go through all the bit strings, and then we check for each one of them whether they are valid proof for the conjecture. And as I said, this step, the checking whether a given bit string is a valid proof for a conjecture, is not hypothetical. This really exists. This can be done. So if you have a program like this, and this program halts, then clearly there exists a valid proof for the conjecture. And if the program does not halt, well, then there exists no proof for the conjecture, because we are stuck in this infinite loop, so apparently we never find a bit string that works as a proof. So there cannot be one. So if we could decide the halting problem, we could just ask whether this particular program halts or not, and the answer would automatically also reveal whether the conjecture has a valid proof or not. Now, on the other hand, if we had some way of designing a Turing machine that could decide whether a conjecture is true or not, I claim we could also solve the halting problem. And this is very simple, because I would just write down a conjecture that says Turing machine M halts on input X. Now, if I could decide whether this statement is true or not, I could also decide whether M halts on X or not, because that is just the statement itself. To summarize, if we could solve the halting problem, we could decide whether a given conjecture has a proof or not. And if we could decide whether a given conjecture is true or not, we could solve the halting problem.